The National Campaign for People's Right to Information was born in 1996 with a meeting organized by Justice Savant and many others, including Prabhash Joshi, Kuldeep Nayyar, Ajit Bhattacharji, and many other activists, including Bharat Dogra, Shekhar Singh, to fight for a RTI legislation. This campaign has been alive since then. It got us the Right to Information Law in 2005, and we've been very preoccupied with the death of RTI activists. Today, one young woman has got killed in Bhopal, who was an RTI activist, been shot dead. So the shocking state of violence against RTI activists brought us together, and we were looking at whistleblowers bill and also at some kind of accountability systems, and the Lokpal was also discussed. The issue was discussed and a small group was formed, and that group was supposed to work on these two bills. So from then onwards there's been a preoccupation with the, in generic terms, with the Lokpal bill and in specific with the whistleblowers bill. At that point another campaign was formed and they started looking at the Lokpal bill. So our position on the Lokpal is an old one, it's not a new one, number one. And number two, we also have, after the differences emerged, because we wanted, they wanted one institution, we wanted five institutions to oversee corruption. We also wanted everybody covered and the rules and the rule of law to prevail on all people. And so did the others. But our contention was that if you create a huge one body, that body will not be able to actually work either administratively efficiently or actually be accountable, because it will be too big and there would be all kinds of issues. What were the five institutions we suggested? We suggested a Lokpal which would look at high level corruption, which would include the Prime Minister, which would include all cabinet members, all top level bureaucracy. And this would look at virtual corruption, which is very difficult to track, for instance, for people like me. Big scams are now international scams, they are huge deals, they actually happen in cyberspace. This will also cover the Prime Minister. The Prime Minister will be liable, but there are two caveats. One is that no vicarious responsibility will be placed on the Prime Minister, it will have to be direct responsibility. For example, a cabinet minister does something or some top level bureaucrat does something, it won't be the responsibility and it won't be the Prime Minister cannot be charge sheeted. Another caveat we put in was that the whole Lokpal, the entire Lokpal, the full bench will sit and hold that there is a prima facie case against the Prime Minister. Then this will be put up to the full bench of the Supreme Court. They will uphold the Lokpal decision. And only then can a Prime Minister be charge sheeted. This is to protect the Prime Minister from day-to-day functioning, and also because there can be many frivolous or irresponsible complaints against the Prime Minister, and he's the head of state. But we have a lot of quarrels with the present government bill. It doesn't include, for instance, Lokayuktas, which we put in because we say there will be a Lokpal at the centre, Lokayuktas at the state level. That's one. The second we thought would be the Judicial Accountability and Standards Bill strengthened, because Justice Verma and Justice Venkatachalaya, Justice Shah, Justice Dave of the Rajasthan High Court, many other people have told us that it is impossible to have justice without independence, and therefore the independence of the judiciary must be maintained. That doesn't mean they will not be under scrutiny, they will be under full scrutiny. But the system will be independent so that there is no circularity. In the other Jan Lokpal, there is a circularity, because the Lokpal will oversee the working of the Supreme Court and the Supreme Court will oversee the working of the Lokpal, and there can be collusion. And if there is collusion, then the judiciousness of the constitution in separating powers will be undone. And that I think is vital, and we all think is vital for a democracy. The third thing is a CVC, a strong CVC without a single line directive, which is what? That now they need to take sanction, there will be no need to take sanction from government. They can proceed and inquire against civil servants, and this will look at bureaucratic corruption. Then we've separated the issue of grievances. Every single household in India has a grievance, and there are so many crores of households. It will be possible to deal with grievances and corruption together. In generic terms also, they fall into completely separate categories. So we said that there should be a grievance redress mechanism which should be bottom up. We already have systems that have started functioning in this country for NREGA. Now there are many rights-based programs like right to food, right to education. There will be many other right to health. There will be many more. So this will all be brought together, and this new institution will not be a financial drain because it will already have funds allocated for these things within those programs which it will take. These other institutions already exist. So they will be in any case under one large Lokpal or separate institutions. We say this will be separate institutions. Finally, there will be a whistleblower's bill, and the whistleblower's bill is extremely important because the whistleblower's bill will take care of people like the young woman who has been shot dead in Bhopal today, but also others within the system who want to blow a whistle when they actually see corrupt practices. Without a whistleblower's bill, you cannot have a corruption-free bureaucracy or a system of governance. This is our package, which we wanted to present it before the Joint Committee of Parliament. The joint committee set up by the government to look at this the Lokpal, and we wanted actually to go and talk before both Pranab Mukherjee, Shri Pranab Mukherjee and Shri Shanti Bhushan. We wrote to the joint committee and they replied to us saying that they would be holding consultations, but they didn't, and they disbanded this joint committee. Thereafter, on the 6th of July, we became public with our position, because after all, in a democratic country, different points of view must emerge, and there are still others. We don't say that ours is the final word. There are still others. For instance, Lok Satta from Hyderabad also has a point of view on judicial accountability and standards, which should also come up before the parliament, and it should also be viewed. Any other points of view that exist must also come, because there is no one single formulation which is ever correct in toto. That's what we have found in our long struggle for laws and legislations.
What do you think about that?
See, personally we feel that everybody has a right to protest peacefully, and we don't think any government can impose conditionalities on free and peaceful protest. But the only thing is that if government feels that it will go out of hand, then it's the government's responsibility to restrain that it doesn't go out of hand. But denial of the right to demonstrate or protest, we think, is undemocratic. No matter what the ends of that protest may be. We do feel that a standing committee is a very good place to go and express your grievances about a law, because the Right to Information Act, which went through Parliament, which went through People's Campaign, then through the National Advisory Council, went to the DOPT. The DOPT then completely, from our point of view, turned it around. They sent it to the Law Ministry, which also diluted it still more. Went to Parliament as a diluted law, it went to the Standing Committee, and after all our presentations and statements against testimonies in front of the Standing Committee, 153 amendments were made to the Right to Information Law by the Standing Committee, and we got a powerful act. So we think that that process should be pushed as much as we can to get a good act out of the Standing Committee.